Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, my name is Philip Sander. It's very nice, the organization. I uploaded this file, I don't know, 5 minutes ago, and it's already there. So this is really nice, and nobody noticed. It looks like it has been prepared weeks ago, right? It just was finished 5 minutes ago. So therefore, it's really nice to have this conference organized so well. Actually, I'm not talking about crypto economics, because at this point of time, I think it's okay to discuss all these topics, but it's also foundational research in Germany. I would call it Grundlagenforschung, and therefore we also need to think about what we can implement now. Research in blockchain is, in my mind, in a very, very early stage, and the reason for this is also because the topic in all is very new. I think everybody knows this, but also you have state-funded institutions such as Fraunhofer, Max Planck, and others. And these are, because they are state-funded, they will not change on the short term. So we can do all kinds of research and discuss things, but you cannot change these structures, which are probably even more slowly changing than financial organizations in like the larger banks. And therefore, I think it's very important to discuss these topics, but we should have in mind that these incumbents, if we call it that way, are state-funded, and with this they cannot change, I would say, not in the next 5 to 10 years. Yeah, I'm from the Frankfurt School of Finance and Management, from the business faculties in Germany, so from the business schools in Germany, there are 400. We are among the top 5 now, so it's a quite good university, but I always have to mention this because people don't know it. We founded the Blockchain Center approximately 2 years ago, over Christmas, 2 years ago, and since that, I think we work quite nicely. We have been the first university in Germany doing this with quite some breadth, and now also others, for example, the Mitweider people are doing a brilliant job. They are also joining this game, so you see here also that research and also universities are joining this field. You see quite much happening in all kinds of disciplines, law, business, computer science, and so on. You see also here on the right-hand side that what we are doing is not just banking and finance. We are also working on topics such as Industry 4.0 and the IoT, Internet of Things topic. So it's quite broad. And actually, when I have to present ourselves very, very quickly, I always say that we are like Fraunhofer. Maybe you know Fraunhofer. Fraunhofer is an institute which provides consulting services, which provides a platform, which also provides seminars, workshops, and conferences. And we are actually exactly like them, but of course much, 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 much smaller, but also much more focused. Yeah, but it's from an image, we are not just doing research, we are not just doing lecturing, we are more applied research, similarly like Fraunhofer. Yeah, so how will blockchain change the way research will be done in the future? And what is future? I would say it's at least plus 5 years from now, maybe plus 10 years. We always have to define it, because I like all the token stuff and the crypto economics, but it's we need quite some years until we get there and until these things will actually be adopted. So if we have a look at how research is being done now, I think nearly everybody in the room knows this. You have the government who is paying money, you have researchers such as PhD students, professors, research groups, and so on. They are getting money, and in between you have research associations or research organizations such as, for example, universities, the German Research Society, DFG, Max Planck, and all these huge organizations, and typically they cost 30 to 45% of the money. So the state spends say 50 million, and the researchers in total get say 30 million because the structure costs money. And with this, you could now say that these organizations in between, they are factually intermediaries, similarly like banks, stock exchanges, similarly like platforms such as Uber. You know all these stories, but actually research organizations like them are nothing else than intermediaries. They take money, they are routing it to the researchers, and of course they need a share to live, and they they justify the money which they need for operations, which is absolutely fine, because they are selecting research. They need to filter many proposals, so they are doing a good work. You know, that's I have to say this definitely. But at the same time, the structure, of course, costs really a lot of money, and in percentage point, I would estimate it to be 30% or 45%. Yeah, there are studies out there, but it's the same with charity institutions. You have now Christmas coming, you have charity organizations, you send 100 euro, they should come to Africa, and the structure costs, say, 20% or 30 or 45% because the structure needs to be operated. And I think blockchain will take some years, but it will change this definitely. So how would it work? You all know this. You have a blockchain structure in the middle. It's the key here is the register function. The register function provides the possibility to store assets. This can be, of course, Bitcoin, but it can also be the euro, it can be tokens, it can be ICOs, whatever. And this structure is nothing else than the new intermediary. And if you now apply the logic from banks and financial organizations to research organizations, then you would now see these research organizations, very importantly, not being replaced, but they have to change their business model similarly to banks. We will also have banks in the future, but they are not doing the transactions. This will be done by blockchain technologies, but they will provide a gateway into the blockchain. And I would assume now that organizations like Fraunhofer, Max Planck, and all these large research organizations, they should provide some kind of gateway into blockchain infrastructure, for example, for doing filtering, screening of research proposals, and so on, as they are doing it now. But the administration part, you know, like taking money, routing it to the researchers, are then being, should be done from an operations perspective by blockchain technology. I learned about this project yesterday. It's called Blockchain Technology Research Institute. You don't need to note it down at this point of time because it's very, very, very small. It's created by two, three researchers in Frankfurt, and they would like to do independent research, but they don't have money. And therefore, they have created their website. And here you see how you can participate. You can, for example, here send money to them, and this is what you get. You get tokens. I would assume, Nina, maybe you can clarify this later on, that these are donation tokens, and then there is some quite interesting law applying because you don't have these classical rules applying. I'm not a lawyer, but according to people in law, the donation tokens are very fascinating. So this could be a donation token, and you see here what you get for your money. You get independent research, so you get also some basic results, and you, of course, you get access to the research results, and you get good karma. And the question is now, is this enough? Is this enough? Actually, no, because there are no transactions coming in. So the point is here that you see that it's an early experiment which could work in the future, but probably what these guys are offering, you can see it here, it might not be enough yet, because maybe you need to sell it more clear, for example, with access to data or access to other things, to make it more plastic, such that you can grasp it in a better way, and then maybe it would work in a better way. But fair enough, these guys are doing this now since 1 or 2 months, so time is very, very early. But I like the idea of just saying, so hey, we are doing research, if you wish, please send us your money. But apparently, so far, it's not working yet. So in the future, I could imagine that it works like as follows. So you have researchers. On the right-hand side, you have those companies or organizations providing money. On the left-hand side, they provide money and they get results and data for it. Yeah. So this way, we are like in the best of all blockchain worlds, which is about monetization of data. So you have data out there. This can be monetized. Typically, we talk about IoT sensors, but you could also monetize the data coming from a PhD student who is writing his research about a specific topic, and then he is providing exclusivity for money, for example, and the money is higher when the exclusivity is more strong, for example. And there is a company here in Berlin called Weave. I think it's opposite of the river not far from here, and they are doing exactly the same architecture in the IoT space. They are providing a blockchain layer for data tokenization and data monetization. Then they provide an IoT layer for connecting the physical world and the blockchain world. And above all, they have the a data marketplace where you can sell and buy your data. And I would think so, but nobody has done it in detail, that research in the future could work in a similar way. So you would have something like an Ethereum backbone for financial transactions. Then you have a Weave network protocol in a similar way, which is organizing the way research is being done, you know, milestones, funding mechanisms, and so on. And above this, in yellow, similarly, you would have specific technical devices providing data, but you could also have PhD students, professors, or research organizations, which are then working on specific tasks according to the protocol, which is organizing research. I'm not sure if there's so much work in this area, probably some early startups, but organizing research through protocols would be very, very, very fascinating. But it's, I think, quite strong in the future. And therefore, the question would then be, will intermediaries such as Max Planck and so on, will they become obsolete? I would say no, because you still need experts for filtering and screening research proposals. I think this is very important. I'm not sure if this can be really outsourced to the crowd. And therefore, I think it's going a similar way like the banking industry, where for example, the banks also need to change, but they will survive more or less. Yeah, so what do we need to achieve this? I think at the end of the day, of course, you need, as I said, specific protocols for research, but underlying this, you need to have money on blockchain systems, and at the end of the day, cryptocurrencies are not enough. You also need to have the euro on a blockchain system, and the reason for this is very simple, because if the government spends money, this money is being spent in euro and not in Bitcoin. So you definitely need the euro. There is no way to simply operate this with ICOs, crazy cryptocurrencies, and Bitcoin. So what I present to you now is coming actually from the financial world, but it's perfectly applicable also to the research area. So what you see here is Ethereum. I have to clearly mention that Ethereum is just one word here. It could also be EOS, it could be a banking consortium or whatever, but Ethereum is well known, and therefore I have put Ethereum here. So why do you need Ether? Because you need to pay for asset transfer. I think everybody knows this, so once you want to transfer a specific amount of money, you need to pay approximately $1 to get these transactions being done. Alternatively, you can pay for business processes. These are called smart contracts. I think most of the people here in the room are knowing this. And smart contracts are looking like follows. So this is a very, very basic smart contract for doing a money transfer. And I think research and the way research is being put in a protocol in the future perhaps would also be organized in such smart contracts, but I think this is a very, very strong effort, which is a very difficult project, because you have to reconcile many, many, many standards in the world to arrive at one joint software code, which is then able to be a protocol for research. But if this works, you can then have ERC-20 tokens, and with ERC-20 tokens, you can create second-order cryptocurrencies on top of Ethereum. Everybody knows this, it's called ICO. And if this works, then people are now starting, and I think this is getting really exciting, they are starting to put traditional currencies on top of Ethereum. So you have the project Stasis, which is now 3-4 months old, and they are putting the euro in an ERC-20 format, and with this they have tokenized the euro, which means they are taking at this point of time 12 million traditional euro, put it on an escrow account. It's basically safeguarded by auditors and a bank, and in the volume of 12 million they are creating 12 million tokens of crypto euro, and with this you now have the euro on Ethereum. You stabilize the prices at exchanges at exactly 1.00, and then you have one crypto euro being equal to one traditional euro, and I think this is exactly what you need, because this is the payment infrastructure you will also have to have in the research world. I don't believe in coins and tokens for research funding, but you need to have the euro, and therefore I think this goes into exactly the same direction. People are also working on putting stocks and all kinds of financial instruments on top of Ethereum. And most interesting, in the future, this has not been done yet, but people are trying it, you could also put research projects on top of Ethereum. You put the milestones in a smart contract, and you not just put one research project on top of Ethereum, but you put, say, 50 or 500 research projects on Ethereum, and then you could ask people to invest or fund these research projects using the crypto euro on top of Ethereum. So this is the underlying euro layer, or yeah, transactional layer you need to have, otherwise blockchain based on or research based on blockchain will not work. And the fascinating thing then is that you can exchange everything with everything. A US person could invest US dollar into a German research project, a South Korean state funding organization could co-invest in a German university, so you have all kinds of people providing money and all kinds of research projects consuming money, and they would then all operate on the Ethereum platform. So this would then allow some kind of seamless funding, same with financial markets, of all kinds of projects on one platform on a worldwide level. I think this is very important. There are no intermediaries, so no Fraunhofer and Max Planck Institutes as we know them, but they would change their role being gateways, and of course you would also have more easier reporting and so on. And similarly to the financial sector, you would then have funds which are collecting stocks and providing, for example, a fund which can be investing in, say, the all German companies. And similarly, you could now, and that's getting really exciting, you could now create funds for research, and these funds are sending money to all research projects in the area of, say, climate change. And then all projects classified that way on a worldwide level would would receive a specific amount of money by this kind of fund which is sitting on top of the single research projects. But this is probably even 15 years from now on. Yeah, and to close this short speech, I would quickly highlight this initiative which we have started. We see that many tokens are being created. That's basically the vision behind this. It's not just ICOs, you also have the crypto euro, you have US dollar, Swiss franc, and everything being sitting on the blockchain in the future. And as I said, it does not need to be Ethereum, could also be EOS and or a banking consortium. You have thousands of stocks in the future on blockchain basis, and also probably hundreds or thousands of research projects. So there will be millions of coins, as the CEO of Binance has said it, there will be millions of coins. And at the same time, these token markets are lacking market standards. And for this reason, we are currently creating an association. And I'm presenting this example because I think after some first weeks, we have gained some positive feedback, because we are setting it up, like, by definition, as a non-profit association, and this makes it very easy for people to contribute. Yeah, so it's not an issue that people would like to contribute and pay, say, an annual fee of 50 euro or 100 euro, but by really focusing on a non-profit character of an association, people also feel that this is similarly to the open source approach, making it broad very quickly, and because with all what you see here on the slide, you could have also formed a company, but we decided to make a non-profit association out of it. Yeah, and because there will be millions of tokens, you need to have a unique identifier. Already now you have Bitcoin with multiple abbreviations. Some call it BTC, others call it XTC, and so you already have confusion there. On CoinMarketCap, the symbol is not unique, so you have a couple of coins which are using the same symbol. Yeah, this should not happen. So we are providing, or the association will provide, an ETIN number, which is providing a unique token identification number, and it will also provide a classification framework. There are many classification frameworks out there, but so far there are not many people out there who have already classified 800 assets as we have done with the association. So we went through CoinMarketCap from position 1 to position 800 and classified these 800 assets according to the classification. And all this data will then be provided more or less for free in a database such that people can use it as soon as possible. Why am I showing you this? Because it seems to work, and a structure like this could also work for pushing the topic of research in blockchain. I'm now jumping over this. I'm also jumping over this. So what did we do here in detail? We are saying that, like others, the classification scheme for tokens has four dimensions. One is the economic purpose. So what is the reason of the token? Why does it exist? Then the second one is the technological setup. What's behind from a technological perspective? Then the third one is the legal claim. So in case you would have a research project focusing on simple donations, then you would not have a legal claim here. And the fourth point is an industry classifications as we know it from existing stock markets. So the economic purpose is splitted as usual in three domains. You have payment tokens, which can be the Bitcoin, which is an unpegged payment token, or the crypto euro, which would be a pegged payment token. Then you have all the utility tokens, that's basically the ICOs of the past 18 months. And you also have an investment token. We did not call it security token because security token implies a local root in a specific legislation, and therefore, because so far we are focusing on the economic purpose, we stayed away from the word security token and therefore called it investment token. There are not many out there, but you see already now that the number of tokens in this class category, the category is called EP03, is rising. The technical setup at this point of time differentiates between native infrastructures, this would be Ethereum and Bitcoin, and second order infrastructures, which would be ICO smart contracts placed on top of first order structures. Legal claim is fascinating because, of course, you have many projects out there where there is no claim. This could be donation tokens, but also pure protocol tokens. Then you also have some relative rights out there. This would be the crypto euro, where you have a right for the collateral, which is stored on the escrow account. And in the future, there might also be absolute rights tokens. Yeah, this would be one analysis how Bitcoin is now classified, including the TCF classes, as we call them. And it shows now, according to first statistics, that the economic purpose is mostly utility tokens. That's basically 18 months of ICOs being now through the system. And now you already see that 5% are investment tokens, even though they are not classified as security tokens mostly. Yeah, so you see that some tokens are clearly investment tokens, but they worked legally around the requirements such that they are utility tokens from a legal perspective. You always need to differentiate the economic purpose and the legal situation. And from a technological setup perspective, you see here that like one third, it's yellow, one third of all tokens are first order cryptocurrencies. That's Bitcoin, Ethereum, and other networks. And 57% are ERC20 tokens. So you see also here that, Ethereum is the platform for ICOs. There is no other significant platform out there. Yeah, with this, I would like to close. I hope I didn't extend the time too much. And we do the questions later on, right? Right. Okay, so note them down, please.
Yeah. Awesome.
And thanks very much.
Thank you, Dr. Philip. Awesome.